the number you have dialed is not in service at this time.
Am I the only one who thinks this is totally insane? Rob, we're fighting theological injustice here.
They're not using just weights and measures.
He said we have 50 listeners. I think he's being generous.
Radio Bible is interpreted by experts.
Rob, are you as shocked as I am?
It's nonsense. If you've given any money to this, you need to complain. Ask for your money back.
I don't know about you, but I find this annoying. What up and shalom. Welcome to the Rob and Caleb Show. Kind of. Welcome to the Rob and Caleb Show, the place where you never know if you're going to hear audio or not.
Or if it's going to be, like, distorted.
Yeah, man. Your internet, I don't know what's going on. We're having so many technical...
I don't know if it's my internet or what.
We're trying so hard today, and we're just failing. What up and shalom, my name is Caleb Haig, and with me as always, Rob Van Hoff. What up, Rob? How you doing, brother?
I'm doing well. I'm really excited.
Why are you so excited?
Because when Gary Springer, we were joking in the chat room about the OG and the UG with Og and Ug. The OG is the Orthodox Gary, the Ug is the unorthodox Gary, but it reminded me of Og of Bashan, King Og.
Yeah.
And it reminded me of a recent news article, and I'm going to have to share this. I'm going to read you something here. It has been long rumored that a work by King Og, the last of the Rephaim giants, was hidden in the secret Vatican library in the Department of Ancient Documents and surviving occult findings.
Oh, no.
In the past few days, the existence of the lost book of the King of Og, the giant, dated circa 1400 BC, has been confirmed by the murkier recesses of the internet. A new website, The Lost Book of King Og, has made available an English translation of the largely extant Chapter 7 of this ancient seven-chapter work. The contents are fascinating. Chapter 7 begins with taunts from King Og to Israel, in which the former appears to compare Israel to ants buried in fecal matter.
What?
There are also tantalizing references to my brethren, which seem to refer to the antediluvian Nephilim. So I just thought that was great. So I posted the link there in our chat room for those who want to...
Yeah, so the chat room is telling us that our audio is horrible. We understand. Look, here's the deal. My computer is dead and in pieces on the Apple fixing table right now. And so
it's in operation.
Yeah, exactly.
It's in surgery.
And so this morning I came in thinking that I was going to have a computer, but I didn't have a computer because they haven't returned it yet. And so I had to quickly try to figure out audio a different way. And actually, the thing that was just recording our audio, Audio Hijack, just bombed on me a few seconds ago. So now I'm going to have to, now I only have one backup recording of audio, which we hope is going to work. And it seems like our internet is slow. We're just having all sorts of problems. Luckily, the one nice thing about my computer is that it's under warranty still because it's brand new. So
they said they're not hearing me. Are you hearing me okay, Caleb?
Yeah, I hear you just fine.
Okay, it says that I am sounding muffled.
Well, yeah, you're certainly gargled. It's like your internet connection is super slow.
Huh.
We can't get anything right today. Anyway.
I think it's a conspiracy.
Is it a conspiracy? Well, here's the other thing. Okay, so...
I think King Og of Bashan has returned. And he's breaking down any naysayers.
Oh, man. Dude, we got some interesting stuff to talk about today. And if people can't hear us, I apologize. I don't know what else to do. This is the best you get today. So check this out. I haven't even told Rob this. Yesterday, I was in the office, I was looking, and lo and behold, what do I see? A comment from Dr. Michael Brown. Now, okay, about a week and a half, about a week ago, right when I returned from the Philippines, I sent a personal message to Dr. Michael Brown, and I said, look, we were in the Philippines, there was a bunch of people there who had listened to Yitzhak Shapiro last year, and they're all turned around. They said that they need to water down the gospel to reach the Jews. They need to change the gospel to reach the Jews because of his book. And I said, you know, this is clearly doing horrible things to the body of the Messiah. Please, I'm asking you again to please, you know, reject this openly. Say that this book has things in it that should not be followed, blah, blah, blah. I hear nothing back from him. And at the end of it, I said, and if you're not going to renounce it, then I'd like to formally ask you to debate me on why you would endorse such heresy.
Ooh.
Yeah. So then yesterday I see a post that he makes on how the anti-missionaries still will not debate him, even though he's requested them to debate him. And so in the chat, in the comment section, I put, interesting, I've asked to debate you on your support of Yitzhak Shapiro's book, but you have not agreed to debate me. And, you know, Michael Brown and I went back and forth. He said, and this is why, okay, first of all, I knew that he was quote unquote trying to hook up a debate between Yitzhak Shapiro and me. That was never going to happen. Yitzhak Shapiro is not stupid enough to come on air. He knows that the Christians that are backing him, if they figure out what he's actually teaching, it's going to be a big problem. It's going to be a huge problem because he's going to lose all of his Christian support. There's no Christian in their right mind is going to be like, oh, yeah, Metatron and Yeshua are the same if they know what Metatron is. So he's like, oh, well, you know, we're trying to hook up this thing between you and Shapiro. But Shapiro, you know, he's afraid that you don't know enough about rabbinics. He says you just don't understand rabbinics. So
you just don't understand, Caleb.
Yeah, yeah.
Apparently. You just don't get it. You don't understand. You don't understand.
That's exactly right. I'm out of the loop, apparently. So anyway, then he deletes the thread, and then he posts something that just says, Caleb, I deleted the thread because this, you know, this is really unfair of you, blah, blah, blah. You shouldn't have come at it this way. So I send him a personal message and I'm like, hey, you know, this isn't just me. It's not just like some kid coming at you here. You know, the staff at Torah Resource all have looked at Shapiro's book, and this is total heresy. And back and forth. And basically, he kept saying, you can call on a Thursday anytime you want. And at first, I was like, yeah, I'll call you on a Thursday. But the more I think about that, the more I'm like, dude, that's a trap. How much time is he going to give a call-in caller to talking about him supporting a heretical book that teaches a false gospel? 5 minutes? He can't even explain what Metatron is in 5 minutes. Anyway. So, total cop-out. You know, honestly, I'm a little bit discouraged by believers. It's like, this guy comes out, he's friends, he schmoozes with everybody. You know, he gets in good, he speaks Hebrew. It's Yitzhak Shapiro, he speaks Hebrew, everybody's wowed by this Israeli. And, you know, then he puts out a book that just teaches sheer heresy and a total false gospel. And but he's everybody's friend, so, oh, we're not going to say anything bad about it. It's like, nobody wants to talk about it. Nobody wants to have a discussion about it. Nobody wants to address the fact that Yitzhak Shapiro is peddling a false gospel to the Jews. And then you got Dr. Brown. You know, I still wonder what his Christian sponsors would think if they knew that he was backing a book that was teaching a false gospel to the Jews.
That's disappointing.
It is.
You know, I there was one thing, a side note. I remember reading in the book, The Kosher Pig, that he says, I'm not Christian. I never was Christian. I wasn't raised Christian. My whole thought world is Jewish through and through. I'm paraphrasing.
Of course.
But then you said that he does altar calls.
Yeah.
So altar call reminds me of, like,
Christian.
The Nazarene Church. I remember.
Dude, he's Pentecostal. That's what he is.
Pentecostals that do the holiness movement kind of thing. So, where in rabbinic, in his rabbinic Jewish training, did he learn to do altar call?
Well, and that's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about.
Could help with that. That'd be good.
That's what I'm talking about in terms of like grease. I'm not saying he's greasing the palms. I'm sure he's not. It's not about money necessarily. But, you know, he's all buddy-buddy with all these charismatics. And that's the point, is that he made friends with all these charismatics. Dude, I don't care. Man, Rob, if you came out, if you wrote a book, and I thought that in the book there was you were teaching a false gospel, sure as day, I would renounce it.
I would want you to renounce it.
I know. I don't
want to be corrected. I'd want to be corrected.
Same here, and I don't understand where people like Michael Brown are coming from. Like, dude is teaching a false gospel to the Jews, and you're promoting it. How is that okay? I mean, at least Brown could do is sit down, read the chapter, come back and have a little bit of a dialogue or something, or mention something like, oh, yeah, you know, like, these people think this is a false gospel. I don't think it is, and this is why. But how are you going to defend Metatron as Yeshua?
Yeah, you're not.
I mean, total nonsense. Absolute nonsense. Okay. Yeah. So, my soundboard isn't working, by the way. I mean, it is.
Mark keeps saying, ouch. Mark, clarify. Is it just the audio that's hurting your ears? Or is it the content of what
is that we're slamming? yeah. I agree. And Andre Philippe, you're right, brother. He says we need to pray for Dr. Brown. Actually, I've been in prayer pretty much ever since yesterday at about 5 o'clock for that the Lord would work on Dr. Brown's heart to soften it and so that he'll actually take a look at what he's promoting.
Yeah, Gary says that would be better if you actually quoted him. In other words, Gary's just saying. What you gave us was kind of a paraphrase.
I gave a paraphrase, but should I actually open up the personal conversation on Facebook? And
I don't know. Maybe it's a good lesson for us, though. We don't have to right now, but in the future.
The fact that
he deleted the thread, obviously he was uncomfortable with keeping it up there.
Yeah. that was my bad. I didn't take screenshots of that before it got deleted, and I should have. Anyway, okay, let's move on then. I got something for you. This, you know, this might win clip of the year, honestly. I got a clip here for you. Somebody tagged me on Facebook, and the only thing that they said was, Caleb Haig, be kind. It's 3 minutes and 10 seconds long. Do you know who Perry Stone is? Perry Stone Ministries. I had never heard of him until this came up. And by the way, okay, if people want written, hang on just a second.
Is he on TBN?
I don't know. It sure seems like it.
Is Perry Stone? Oh.
Hang on just a sec.
It sounds like. Was it Perry?
I don't want to be accused of not using references here. Hang on just a sec. Okay, so while I look for this, listen to this by Perry Stone. Okay, now this is very appropriate, by the way. Very, very appropriate for
Be kind, rewind.
This is
remember the Be Kind Rewind,
yes.
On the VHS rentals.
Okay, so this for our Passover that's coming up in less than 3 weeks.
At the crucifixion of Jesus, you have read the story that Pilate put a title over the cross. What most people do not know is in the time of Passover, Jewish people would take a bronze name tag and tie it around the neck of their lamb just to show God that they're keeping the Passover. If I take a lamb representing my family and maybe another poor family, I would put the name Stone on this bronze name tag around the neck of that lamb. And when it's offered, God would know I have kept the Passover and have presented my lamb. The family name had to be on the lamb, okay? Here's what Pilate did to the inscription on the cross. And Pilate wrote a title and put it on the cross, and the writing was Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. This title was read by many of the Jews, for the place where Jesus was crucified was nigh to the city, and it was written in Hebrew and Greek and Latin. Forget the Latin, forget the Greek, because in Jerusalem they don't speak Hebrew. But the question is, what did they say in Hebrew? Now, what you have to do is this. The New Testament is written in Greek. So you've got to take the Greek language of Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews, and translate it back to Hebrew. If you know anything about Greek, the key letter is the letter Omicron in Greek. Omicron, because it can be translated of V as the or of. For example, in Pergamos, there was an inscription to a temple of Zeus, and here's what it says. Zeus of Pergamos, and King and God. And the and there is the Omicron. Zeus of Pergamos and King and God. Pilate probably got that title idea from that temple that was in Pergamos. Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. All right, if you take it from Greek and translate it back to Hebrew, it's on the cross. And the religious Jews are going nuts looking at this. It translates in Hebrew, Yeshua Hanetzret Vomelik Kehudin. Means nothing to you sitting there. I know it means absolutely nothing. But if you're Catholic or you're from a Catholic background, you know that Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews, in Latin, that if you take the first letter of Jesus, it's an I. Nazareth is the letter N in Latin. King is Rex. So it's an R. And the Jews, the J is an I. So that's why on crucifixes, you have I-N-R-I. Anybody ever wondered that, why you have a little I-N-R-I? That is Latin for the first letters of Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. Wait a minute. What if we do it in Hebrew? If you drop Yeshua HaNatzret V'melech HaYudim and take the first letter, hey, and drop it down, show them what it spells in Hebrew. Yod, Hey, Vav, Hey, which is Yahweh. You're going to get this in a minute.
Oh, my goodness gracious. Wrong.
He goes on about how Pilate put up this thing that God is hanging on the cross.
Okay, let's take this. Claim number one, that we would hang a name, a family name, over a lamb. Okay, he doesn't go into any evidence of that. Maybe some people did do it, but that's a stretch right there.
Oh man, it's so bad.
Number two. I like one for eternal facepalm. The idea, like you're just pointing, like Pilate probably copied this Zeus temple idea, is so crazy. Three, the way he pronounces he obviously doesn't know Hebrew. First of all, because he said Vumelech or something like that, Vamelech. In front of a mem, it's U. So it would be Umelech if it was and. But there is no and. And his idea about the Greek Omicron is nonsense. This guy is so wrong. He's using false information, false sensation. This goes way back to, is it Ben Mordecai? Who was the guy who wrote the Messiah books back in the 90s? And I think Andrew Gabriel Roth is on this page. That this is an epic fail. it's yeah. No. It doesn't work that way. There is no and there. There is no vav. Yeah.
I'm writing down times right now. So
and
I can,
the idea
so
that it would be Yeshua Ha Notzri, that we don't even know. We don't know that there's a hey in front of Notzri. That yes, it would be a yod, would be the first letter. And maybe it ends in a hey, ha Yehudim, maybe. But there are many, many, many difficulties.
See, I didn't even have to do anything.
Here's another aspect of this.
Keep going.
Many times in the Gospels, when it says in the Hebrew dialect, it's actually talking about Aramaic.
Yeah.
Like the words like Golgotha, Maranatha, Abba. What are some of the others that we have? Gehenna, Mammon, like Mammon. Like these are all Aramaic terms. The word manna for manna, that's an Aramaic. It's not Hebrew. Manna in the desert. It talks about manna. When the New Testament talks about manna, they use the Aramaic word manna. All these words, when it says that they are Aramaic, or it says they're Hebraic, it just means it's of the language that is of the Hebrews. And it doesn't necessarily mean what we think today, Hebrew versus Aramaic. So it's in other words, it could have been in Greek, Latin, and Aramaic, what we would call Aramaic today. There's just so many things wrong with that. And this is...
I knew this would be good.
I'm glad you found that clip, Caleb, because this is an example of what is wrong. How does this increase discipleship for Yeshua? How does this increase people seeking to grow in their love of God with all their heart, soul, and strength, neighbor as themselves? How does it help them? It's a sensationalist. First of all, it's wrong. What gain do we have for Yeshua's kingdom? What possible gain is there for Yeshua's kingdom in the earth and his glory if someone is peddling something that is factually untrue, that is false? What good is that for Yeshua's kingdom?
But
it's the divine name on the cross. What good is it if it's a lie?
But hey, that's what's going on in the Messianic and the Christian world today. Look, man, all of the Aleph Tav, all of the Hebrew word pictures, all this, it's false, and it might sound good, but it's false.
Boy. You precious listeners out there, you in our chat room, learn to discern, and I'm so grateful for
it. Learn to discern.
Just learn to discern. This is so important, because where the rubber meets the road, we need to know where we can stand. We want to build our house on the rock. We want to dig down. We want to be like the wise person that Yeshua says, who hears his word and digs down deep. You keep digging until you hit rock. This teaching that this Perry guy just gave is not rock. But yet he's riling up an entire crowd.
Oh, they bought it hook, line, and sinker.
He's stirring up a crowd into this emotional frenzy. But you know what? They're going to go back into their lives, and you know, any seed that could have been sown, the vultures are going to come and snatch up.
Okay, so since I got slammed in the do your Sid Roth impression. I can't believe. Okay. since I got slammed in the chat room for not giving references to Dr. Michael Brown, here you go. Dr. Brown says to me, this is shameful how you would put this in a thread. In a comment section on a Facebook post, you're missing the point. And I wrote, then I couldn't respond to him because he had deleted my post. So I wrote him a personal message in response. I said, I believe it is a shame that you're not getting the point. Do you think it's just me saying this? The entire staff of Torah Resource, including Rob Van Hoff, who teaches a course in rabbinics, believes this book is heresy. Now, I said that because he had asserted that Itzhak Shapira doesn't want to debate me because I don't know anything about rabbinics. So I say, if someone challenges an endorsement I made on a book stating it was heresy, I would look at the references and address it, no matter if I thought they were right or not. Yet your name remains on this book that is sheer poison to any Jew that picks it up. He writes back and he says, Caleb, this is really not the thing to be doing. You do not have the slightest clue how much is on my plate and how many people have something to argue with me. See, but that's just it, is that he's been on our show before. I consider Dr. Brown...
But that's part of his territory. He chose to be on that field.
Yeah, exactly. And not only that,
so he's saying you're weakening him rather than strengthening him.
But here's the point, is that I would consider Dr. Brown somewhat of, I mean, maybe not a friend, but an acquaintance, right? I mean, he's been on our show before. We've talked back and forth. I've talked with him and set up the whole thing with my dad on his show and all that kind of stuff. I mean, we have a working relationship. It's not like I'm just some schmo coming and being like, oh, yeah, you know, you did this wrong. No. I mean, this. There's clearly something, you know, there's clearly a relationship that's been built here. He says the phone lines are open and you can call. Well, that's a trap. The more you do this, the more I see something very wrong. So one last time, call the show and have at it. But drop the communication here. Last request. And of course, I say, I will call the show, which actually I've rethought that after especially getting some counsel. I will also be pursuing other avenues since you refuse to pull your endorsement or even address it. Shalom. And he writes back. He's got to get the last word. He can't leave something. He writes back and he says, threats like this get you a massive downgrade. Threats like what? That I'm going to talk to other people?
Downgrade in what?
Yeah, exactly. In his eyes, in me getting on his
man.
Yeah, I don't understand. I just don't understand that. Anyway, so threats like this to get you massive downgrade. To say I'm disappointed in your behavior is an understatement. May the Lord teach you humility and grant you wisdom. Please be kind enough not to reply again. Thanks. Well, of course, I had to reply to that. I said, Dr. Brown, in love, please understand, you specifically said that if anyone has anything to say about the book, you would get them on the show. You and Shapiro will still not address how you support such heresy. You will not hear from me again, but I sure hope you will pray and seek God on why your name is staying on something that teaches such falsehood. Wow. And of course, he has to write back again. Caleb, I'm shocked. You cannot even comply with a simple request repeated over and over again. You have just about disqualified yourself from getting on the air. See, he thinks that that's a big point to me. I don't care about your show. I could care less about getting airtime on the Line of Fire or whatever. What I care about is that he's supporting a book that is teaching a false gospel. He says, leave it here, learn some humility and wisdom, and do not reply again. Otherwise, you'll be blocked here. I do not have time to deal with this, and you do not get it. You don't have time to deal with the true gospel. You don't have time to deal with a book that you've endorsed that's teaching a false gospel. Isn't that what our job is in ministry? That's what our time is for. Our time is for preaching a true gospel. Our time is for trying to uphold the true gospel, not hand people a false gospel. That statement right there really ticks me off. You don't have time for it? Then what are you doing in ministry? If you don't have time for it, get out of ministry. That's the point.
Yeah, that's right. He signed his name on the book.
Yeah, exactly.
So
there you have it. There you have it, chat room. I hope that's enough reference for you.
I'm jonesing for some gematria.
Speaking
of kosher pigs.
Okay, well, here's the deal. We can try this. I think that this is going to not do well for us, but we will try nonetheless. Let's try some music here, okay? See? Sorry about that, guys. I told you
This is show number 119.
My soundboard is messed up. Keep going.
The gematria, of course, is 119.
119.
Not to be confused with Psalm 119.
Or 119 Ministries.
Yeah, which I don't know. Do they exist anymore? I don't know. Hahuk. The decree. Hahuk. He chet vav kuf. Hahuk. 119. Here's another. Ben Oni. That's what Rachel says as she's dying and gives birth to who Yaakov or Jacob renames Benjamin. Ben Oni.
Son of my pain.
Son of my affliction. Son of my strength. If own could be strength, we don't know. Genesis 35:18, though. Ben Oni.
Mm-hmm.
Here's another. Mata. In Isaiah 60, verse 21, or Isaiah 61:3, the planting of the Lord. It talks about all my people will be righteous forever. They're a planting of the Lord Matah. And finally, I have one more. I have a couple more, but I'll just do one more. And it's the same letters as Matah, just switched around. Ta'am. Ta'am is a word for taste or discernment. Ta'am. Gary, King Og, will know this one. Ta'am. It's in the Proverbs. And in the Psalm, it says Ta'amu. Taste and see, Ki Tov Adonai, that the Lord is good. So Ta'am, taste and discern. And I think discern is a good word for, I think Gematria is on our side today, Caleb. Because learn to discern.
Yes.
Learning for discerning. And what I think someone said their favorite was learnment for discernment.
Okay, so let's try the music out. If it gets too bad, then I'll stop it. it's so
you
off.
You know what it is? Is it normally stereo?
Probably.
I think we're getting like maybe one channel.
One channel, yeah, I think you're right. Anyway. All right, fine. Well, that's what you can do. Okay, so let's see here. Well, we've spent 31 minutes now talking about things that weren't even on the agenda to talk about, which is okay. I don't have a problem with that. You sent me an email and really this show is basically like, let's tie up some loose ends before we, before I get my computer back and we really, get back into it. This whole Philippines trip has really kind of thrown me off. Adam says that he would call him, but he doubts that that Brown would even discuss the topic. I totally agree.
And when I look at Adam's beard, I think Dr. Brown had run the other way.
Yeah.
That's my thought.
Okay, so you wrote me an email this last week.
I do that every once in a while.
The Israel Bible.
I think to myself, hey, I'm going to email Caleb.
Let's talk about the Israel Bible. Dude, I have to say, websites are becoming so annoying. Have you noticed this new thing that they're doing where if you're about to close the window, then they're like, the whole screen goes dark and this thing pops up and it's like, wait, don't leave, sign my email list. Right. Oh, that's annoying. Anyway, okay, so the Israel Bible, tell me about it.
So, as I think you supplied a link for in our show notes.
I did.
The Israel Bible beta version produced by Orthodox. I'll just read here. I'm under the statement of beliefs. Mm-hmm. The Israel Bible, TM, was created to honor the God, the people, and the land of Israel. Remind me of FFOZ there for some reason. From an Orthodox Jewish perspective, with our rich content and robust discussion of biblical text, we hope to connect with Jews and Christians who appreciate the biblical significance of the land of Israel, the God-given land of the Jews. And it goes on to say, the rise in number of Christians who are interested in studying the Bible from a Jewish perspective. It says the numbers of supporters recognizing Israel as the God-given home of the Jews is growing, and with Jews and Christians studying together, we believe we can make a difference in history. And it goes on to say what the guidelines are of this discussion. So the Israel Bible is an online Bible translated and moderated with forum discussions.
No, I think I'm just like,
by Orthodox.
So, is it just
Jews.
the old Tanakh, or is it?
Yeah, just the Tanakh.
Okay.
And then there's comment guidelines. So, in other words, we want to create. This is the message. We Orthodox Jews in Israel want to produce an English translation of a fresh English translation of the Tanakh, and we want to moderate discussions between Jews and Christians.
Sure.
Okay. So, because of all the love for Jews being in the land of Israel. And it says, the Israel Bible, it says, we encourage open dialogue and welcome respectful questions. However, since we are an Orthodox Jewish site, Bible study is intended to be from an Orthodox Jewish point of view. That's it, not Christian scripture. So we ask our readers, that our readers are sensitive to our, quote, mixed audience and follow the guidelines when commenting on our site. So obviously comments must be respectful and non-offensive, okay? Comments must not promote a Christian agenda, such as proselytizing. Well,
what does that mean?
So no gospel, right? No saying you have to repent and believe. comments.
Wait. Let's go back for just a second. So I have to assume then from the second one, comments must not promote a Christian agenda such as proselytizing. I have to assume then any talk of the sacrificial system is out. Any talk of Yom Kippur or Passover is out. Any talk of Isaiah 53:7-1 is out. Psalm 22 has to be out, or 23 rather. Right.
Well, look at the third bullet. Comments should stay focused on the Hebrew Bible and not refer to Christian scripture. So you can't refer. I'll tell you what, Caleb. Jews and Christians come to this party. A bunch of Orthodox Jews. We have Christians here. We're going to discuss the Bible. We're encouraging Christians to, you know, they can give us money if they want. What we're going to do is we're going to have a discussion, mature discussion. But Christians, check your Christianity at the door. No, you can't quote the Gospels. You can't promote any kind of Christian agenda. But you can come fellowship with them. We'll have fellowship together. But, and we're doing this all for the goodwill of humanity. But it's got to be, our perspective is the perspective that has to be respected, and you have to check your brain and anything else at the door.
It's like someone trying to say to, like, hey, let's open a conversation between us evangelicals and the Mormons. Now, Mormon people, we invite you to come in and talk all about your faith, but you're not allowed to talk about Joseph Smith, the Book of Mormon, the Pearl of Great Price, or the Doctrine and Covenants. In fact, no Mormon doctrine whatsoever. You can only talk about our doctrine. How is that a conversation?
I like Adam's comment. It should be a bat, not beta version. Yeah, why are they? And then I like Iconoclast. He says, so Jews can proselytize the Christians.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like,
hey, you know what this reminds me of? This reminds me of something. Remember the other week when we were talking about Hanok and Pete Rambo? Have you ever been on Hanok's site?
No.
You haven't? Oh, go on his site sometime. Look at some of the comments. He has a whole... Okay, enough with the chat room. Right here, Rob. Come on, man. He has a whole...
Let me finish. I just said beta and bet are the same in Paleo-Hebrew. So...
The jokes counts. Are getting worse and worse on this show. Listen, so Hanok, he has this whole page of bringing Christians to Judaism.
What?
Yeah, and all these ex-Christians are like, oh, thank you so much for bringing me out of the Christian church and into Judaism. Somebody sent it to me.
Oh, wow.
So basically...
Itchy ears.
Yeah, exactly. So Pete Rambo and what's his name? Ken Rank. We don't need to evangelize the Jews because they're okay. So let's bring the Jews in. Let's bring Hanok in and be a part of our ministry. And then he can go ahead and proselytize to the Jews back to Judaism. I'm going to turn the chat room off. I'm going to kick you out of the chat room.
Okay. I'm covering it up. I can't believe it, Caleb. I'm hearing what you're saying. What? Yeah.
Yeah.
It's upsetting.
I mean, it's the same kind of thing as here, though. It's like these people are like, oh, yeah, come study the Bible with us. And Iconoclast is right. Come study the Bible with us so that we can...
So we can proselytize you. We're not yeah. Budging. And you can't bring... who you are. If you're born again, if
you
God
cannot,
has put the spirit, if God yeah. has put the spirit of Messiah,
you cannot not
Son
talk
in
about
your
it.
Heart by which you cry Abba Father, and that's who you are, and you are a new creation in Messiah.
Yeah.
And you submit just because you want to please, you have this inkling to please men and be in these kinds of conversations, you are denying who you are.
Yeah, exactly.
You're Yeah.
Preach, brother, that's preach.
Frustrating.
It is frustrating.
People don't, if they buy into this, say, oh, I can do that, they are like lamb headed for the slaughter.
No doubt.
They don't have, not in a way that is going to honor Yeshua, but in a way that is just for waste.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, you sent me another part of the email, and what was this one? This one was breaking Israel news. Oh, it's the documentary. And actually, did you look at some of the comments in this? Okay, you set it up because you're the one who.
No, I didn't look at the comments.
So, but you sent the email.
Yeah, it'd be interesting to talk to the guy who's trying to do it.
Okay, but set up what it is. Tell our audience what you're looking at.
There's an Israeli messianic missionary. Apparently, his name's Jacob Damkani. I am totally ignorant out to who he is. He says he claims to have introduced tens of thousands of Jews to Jesus and Christianity. So my understanding is that Yaakov Damkani is an Israeli Jew, lover of Yeshua, who is preaching Yeshua and the gospel to Jews in Israel. That's what I'm understanding. And then he's created some movies. What happened?
Yeah, he's creating like
I lost my link, went to a different link all of a sudden.
That's weird. Dude, this website is so annoying.
So this article called Provocative Documentary explores one man's messianic mission, and it's written by an Adam Eliyahu Berkowitz, March 31st, 2016. But the quote, they quote the Israel Bible right off the top. It did it again.
Okay, here, I got it. Here's the quote. Jacob Damkani's mission is twofold: bringing Jesus to the Jews while presenting Jesus as a Jew to Christians. But a Jew cannot accept Jesus and remain a Jew, just as a Christian must accept Jesus in order to be a Christian. His message is unacceptable to Jews, but his vision of Jesus as a Jew has drawn a strong following of evangelicals. In his own way, Damkani is trying to bring the two Abrahamic religions closer, and perhaps, to some degree, he succeeds. Unfortunately, he also pushes people apart. The movie reinforces the common Jewish fear of Christian proselytizing, bringing it closer to home for Israelis. To have an Israeli Jew join this effort is incredibly destructive, leading Jews to suspect Christians even more. Amazing changes are taking place in relations between Judaism and Christianity, and proselytizing is no longer part of that.
Right.
With the common threat of Islamic Jihad and overwhelming secularism, Christianity is choosing a productive alliance with authentic Israel-based Judaism, rejecting a path that requires Jews to convert. In this new reality, Damkani's mission is a problem and not a solution.
Okay, so thank you. Thanks for that's towards the end of the article. So it starts out saying, hey, there's this messianic Jew. He's created a documentary. He's reaching out, all this. And then all of a sudden it pulls the rug as you read the article from under the whole thing. It says this guy's dangerous, etc. Here are some of the key points, he says. In the guy writing the article says, but a Jew cannot accept Jesus and remain a Jew, period. That's a bold assertion that he makes. A Jew cannot accept Jesus and remain a Jew. Which means, and then he says, just as a Christian must accept Jesus in order to be a Christian. His message is unacceptable to Jews. So, yeah, that is problematic right there. We would never say that a Jew who accepts Yeshua ceases being Jewish. You know,
my grandmother said that.
What's that?
My grandmother said that.
Yeah, so this is a folk belief.
Yeah.
You see, you know what I mean? It's a folk...
See, but what I see happening is the same thing. Look, this is like a running theme that we've been going on for like the past couple of shows. You have Ken Rank and Pete Rambo and this Hanok guy, and they're like, oh, we don't need to evangelize. And this isn't even
they're
new.
They're buying into this. Yeah. They're buying into this.
This isn't even new because what's his name from the UMJC? We saw at the ETS, we saw a... Kinzer, Mark Kinzer. He's been preaching that the Gentiles should be go back to the Catholic Church for years. Right. You know, that Messianic Judaism is part of Judaism, and the Messianic Jews should be in the Messianic synagogue, and the Gentiles need to go back to the Catholic Church.
This last sentence here, Christianity, quote, as if, you know, is choosing a productive alliance with, get this, authentic Israel-based Judaism.
Yeah, what's that?
And then it says, rejecting a path that requires Jews to convert. So, but yeah, what they're imagining is something called AIBJ, Authentic Israel-Based Judaism. I guess it's a new... Do you realize how many Judaisms there are in Jerusalem that disagree with each other?
I know.
And so, and now somehow Christianity is in a productive alliance with this authentic Israel-based Judaism.
Of course.
And so Jews and Christians can live forever in harmony, and we're going to use Ezekiel 37 to try to create a midrash. Oh, we're Joseph. You're Jacob. Or you're
Esau.
Judah. And we're being one together, and we're not going to tell you to change. You keep, keep that. You can call the Zohar holy. You can call all the, you know, all your midrashim and mystical tradition as holy tradition, and we're gonna we'll keep holding to the gospel, I guess. But we'll be sure to check it at the door whenever we do want to have these discussions with you.
I'm getting slammed in the chat room today for not quoting. So people are asking for quotes on Kinzer. I've quoted Kinzer on this show many times. But okay, yeah, granted, I'll get some quotes for you. I'll get some quotes for you next week. The point is that, you know, Kinzer is basically, and maybe he hasn't come right out and say we don't need to evangelize the Jews, but obviously Ken Rankin and Pete Rambo have. I mean, that's right on their site. And we did a whole show on that, right? And we have, you know, this thing going on. In last week, I talked about how in the Philippines, I had people, and not just one person. There was one specific person who kind of kicked it off, but there were numerous people who kind of had this idea that the Jews don't need to be saved; they're already saved because they keep Torah. This show would be better if you were actually quoting sources. Thanks. We know.
Yeah.
Okay.
We should quote sources.
Well, I'm sorry. I didn't think that I was going to... I'm shooting from the hip here.
I think for now, we could just say, I think Dr. Kinzer, one of his books is
post-missionary
Messianic Judaism. And the implication is post-missionary. There's no more mission to the Jews.
Yeah, exactly.
There is no mission to the Jews. Then you have someone like our brother for Chosen People Ministries, who's working in Brooklyn, Bobby W. And wow, he has an amazing video out lately talking about how many unreached Jews there are in Brooklyn alone that need the gospel. And he's on the front line there trying to teach and reach those Jews with the good news of Yeshua. I love that. I'm so excited for his ministry. These are two completely different world views that engage the Jewishness of Yeshua and the place of Torah in the life of the Ecclesia, but they're two different maps of the world, and the one that we're seeing here by this this idea that a Jew can't believe in Yeshua and remain a Jew, that's scary man-made religion that makes that kind of claim.
Well, I think don't you think it ultimately goes back to replacement theology? Because if you're Jewish and you accept Christ, according to the church, obviously, if you're Jewish and you say, and I shouldn't even use that, the church, what is that? So according to some streams of Christianity, if you're Jewish, and I should say some streams of replacement theology, if you're Jewish and you accept Christ, you stop being a Jew because God rejected the Jews and chose and took the church instead.
Now, have there been, is that in the tradition of larger Christian history? Sure, there have been groups that have taught that, but we reject that.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. But what I'm saying is that it seems like he's just picking up a common thread of replacement. I shouldn't say a common thread, but at least one vein of replacement theology, right?
They're promoting a lie.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
They're promoting a lie. No one benefits from that. It serves to keep a wall of distinction that it tries to tell a Christian, this is the kind of Christian you need to be. You need to be the kind of Christian that doesn't tell a Jew the gospel. And you need to be a kind of Christian that tells a Jew to go to Judaism. And you need to be kind of, or sorry, you need to be a kind of Christian that does not tell a Jew the gospel. You need to be a kind of Christian that stays in the church. And you got to let the encourage the Jews to be Jewish and practice Judaism so that we can have these two religions, Christianity and Judaism.
Don't you think that that downplays the gospel in terms of, I mean,
yeah.
Don't you think that it's, I think it's actually a miss on the gospel.
Yeah.
I think it's a misunderstanding of the gospel in general.
Yep.
I think it's also a misunderstanding of sin and God's holiness, which is really a shame. Do you think, I don't think these people are trying to be, I mean, they're not sitting.
I think they're ignorant. I think they're
exactly.
ignorant and zealous for the wrong thing.
They're not sitting in the back room wringing their hands thinking of how they can deceive people, right?
Right. I think they're just zealous for the wrong thing. Like Paul says, you know, they have a zeal for God, but not according to
knowledge. In my opinion, it goes back to friendship a lot of it. Look, we've talked about this. Look, Pete Rambo seems like a really nice guy. Seems like a really nice dude. And Ken Rank does too. But they got this really good friend, Hanok, who's Jewish, Orthodox. They want, you know, they want to include him. They want to be a witness to him in whatever way they can. But they can't imagine him going to hell. You know, he's such a nice guy. And he's you know, he lives out Torah the best he can and all these kind of things. So they, you know, they have to some way twist it. You know, they have to try to make it fit their theology so that their friend can be in. "Quote unquote in." It's the same with Dr. Brown. It's like Itzhak Shapira has made really good friends with Dr. Brown. Dr. Brown can't go and tell his friend that he's teaching a false gospel, especially after he's put his name on it, right? I mean, it just seems to me like human friendship here, it takes the trump card over truth and the gospel. Man, that is scary to me. Because Paul specifically says in Galatians 4 that anyone who preaches a different gospel than the one that Paul's preaching, and, well, he says the one that we are preaching, I assume that he's talking about the apostles, Timothy, himself, right? So anyone who preaches a different gospel than the one we're preaching is accursed. Man, that's scary to me. Sorry. The last thing I want to do is be upholding a false gospel. That's why I think it's really important for teachers and people who are putting their teachings out there, even you and me, Rob. I mean, it's really important for us to be very solid on what we believe the gospel is and what we see the gospel to be in the scriptures.
If we don't, Caleb, you're right. If we don't, that means we're not building on rock.
Yeah, exactly.
If I can't if my house isn't going to stand strong in any storm, then I haven't dug deep enough, right? I'm building on sand. If something's going to knock me over, then I'm building on sand, and that's not the wisdom of Yeshua. Yeshua says, dig till you find rock, then build a foundation.
Well, and the other thing is that, look, if your friends are really, you know, not getting the true gospel, it doesn't do any favors to try to twist the gospel to get them in. A better favor to them would be to stand up for the truth and say, look, you're wrong. I love you, but you're wrong. And this is the true gospel. And you might not agree with me, but I'm going to preach the true gospel to you because otherwise, what are you doing? You know, just like, I don't know. It baffles me. You know, the whole thing with Dr. Brown the other day, it just made me really sad. And it wasn't because it made me sad because I'm not going to be on his show, which I think is what he thinks. What makes me really sad is that you have a brother in the Lord that I truly believe is a brother who seems to love the Lord. He's pushing on, you know, we disagree strongly on a lot of issues, Dr. Brown and I do, but I think that we agree on the fundamentals, you know, the deity, the Messiah, the Trinity, you know, these kind of things. But that's what really made me sad is that it's like, here you have a brother who just doesn't seem to care at all to address what's going on. You know, the true gospel that needs to be preached as opposed to the false gospel. I could care less about my name being on his show. That doesn't matter to me at all. Okay. We got one more little paper here. This was interesting. Jets came out. We got our March issue of Jets. If you don't know what Jets is, it's the Journal of the Evangelical Theological Society, which both Rob and I are members of, the Evangelical Theological Society. And actually, what do you think, Rob? I really enjoy getting these now.
Yeah, I like it.
They usually have...
It's hard. I don't have time to always read through all of them.
Yeah, they usually have, I don't know, maybe anywhere from 8 to 10 various authors who contribute to each... basically, people write papers, they send them in, and then they choose, you know, 8 to 10 of the papers to put in here. So every month you get a new one with different authors writing on different subjects and different papers. And so this one caught my eye. Did you read this one?
The one about the...
Yeah, so it's called the role the law does or does not play in the condemnation of Gentiles in Romans 2, 12 through 15. Did you read it?
Yeah.
What'd you think?
He doesn't come to his own conclusion.
And that's what annoyed me, too.
He didn't actually come down on... he says these are possible scenarios.
Yeah, and that's he's kind of doing an overview. But, I mean, that's not really what Jets is for, right?
No, I mean, I think he's working on his PhD, so maybe this article. Usually, guys who are working on a PhD are encouraged to publish an article as a sound, like to put something out there as they're writing their dissertation, and then they get feedback, and then that helps them sharpen their final dissertation. I get the sense that that's what this person is doing.
Okay.
Just to recap, I'll give a real overview. I don't have it in front of me, it's upstairs, but. He basically says in Romans chapter 2.
Okay, hang on just a sec. Let's read Romans 2, 12 through 15 real quick. That'll lay the groundwork, okay? I'm reading out of the ESV here. For all who have sinned without the law, the Torah, or the law, will also perish without the Torah. And all who have sinned under the Torah will be judged by the Torah. For it is not the hearers of the Torah who are righteous before God, but the doers of the Torah who will be justified. I apologize.
It's Dr. Brown.
Probably. For when Gentiles who do not have the Torah by nature do what the Torah requires, they are a Torah to themselves, even though they do not have the Torah. They show that the work of the Torah is written on their hearts, while their conscience also bears witness and their conflicting thoughts accuse or even excuse them. Go.
Okay, one thing is that that's the ESV, right?
That's correct.
Okay, so where you have the comma, who do not have the Torah, comma, by nature do, or is it who do not have the Torah by nature, comma, do? Now, in Tim Hague, your father's commentary, the Greek is ambiguous, and I think your dad shows excellent support that the comma should be after nature, who do not have the Torah by nature. That is, in other words, they don't have they weren't raised in a Jewish home. In other words, they're not.
Yeah.
They don't have the Torah in terms of growing up with it. So they're adults, people who have a different culture, a non-Torah culture, a foreign culture.
Are you talking about 12? See, I take a different view on that.
Who do not have the law by nature, comma. And that's your. I like your dad's comments.
Maybe it's the same thing, but maybe it's a different analogy. I think he's heralding back to chapter one. For all who have sinned without the law, without the Torah, will perish without the Torah. Mm-hmm. In other words, you know, the same argument that goes on today was going on there. What about the guy in the bush in Africa who's never heard the gospel, who's never heard about it? And Paul basically, you know, and we hear this in chapter one. He says, all you have to do, I'm paraphrasing, obviously, all you have to do is look outside. The heavens and the earth declare the wonders of God. So he's going back to it. For all who have sinned without the Torah, in other words, who don't have Torah, who haven't heard about it, will perish without the Torah. In other words, they'll still perish. It's not an excuse. You can look out your window and know that there's a God and know that you need a relationship with him. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, well, here we're talking about, but he says the Torah. If they don't, they do what the Torah requires. That this is evidence that says it shows the work of the Torah is written on their hearts. Now, what this the author in the ETS journal says is that he suggests, is Paul really quoting Jeremiah 31 here? In other words, yeah, some people could say, oh well, Paul's clearly quoting New Covenant. Promise to Jeremiah that the Torah written on the heart, and he's including Gentiles. But he wants to take a grammatical quibble and say, actually, Jeremiah says the law is written on the heart. What Paul says is that it's the work of the law that's written on the heart. And so this word written is modifying the word work, not the word law. So it's the work that is written on the heart. And so he takes that little wedge and says Paul's, we could equally read this as that it's not talking about new covenant, new life in Messiah, where the writing of the Torah is on the heart, but that it's this general, and this, he says, this is where he, I wonder if he reads Kinzer, because he talked about destiny, and he talks about stuff that sounds very Kinzer-esque, but I don't think he quoted Kinzer, but that all mankind have a certain light that is in them, and that God will judge them according to their light, according to the light that is in them. And that also reminded me of Kinzer.
Yeah, I think quote that from Kinzer.
What the point is here, in my reading, is that this is talking about believers in Yeshua. Gentiles who do not have the Torah by nature, but end up doing the Torah, they show the work of the law written on their heart. That means they are new creations in Messiah, and they want to do the will of their Heavenly Father,
and even
which
if,
is in the Torah.
And
it's
even,
very simple.
I agree with you completely, but even if Paul isn't referencing the new, isn't referencing Jeremiah 31:31 here, it still applies. The Torah written, you know, it still brings up new covenant imagery.
Yeah. Would Paul get this idea of any kind of Torah or work of Torah written on the heart, if not from Jeremiah? There's a
reference in Deuteronomy that the Torah.
Yeah, circumcision of the heart is.
And
yeah.
written on the heart, I'm almost positive.
Not written, circumcision of the heart, though.
Okay, let's check it.
It's the same point, but I don't think Torah written on the heart is in Deuteronomy. But in any event, and then the conscience, somehow I was disappointed. The author talks about, well, these are Gentiles who occasionally do what God wants, that somehow they're going to be justified. And it's like, no.
Well, yeah.
No, this is people, and, you know, a good passage. Now, he was focusing just on Romans. But if we look in 1 John, what does it say in 1 John? It says, if you say you have no sin, you deceive yourself. His word is not in you. Right?
Yeah.
In other words, it's God's word in our heart that shows us the sin. It's his light that he puts in our heart that we see where the sin is. And then we confess our sins. He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins, cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Okay, that's the relationship we're in with Yeshua, with new covenant hearts, is that we have God's Torah written on our heart, and we grow in being children of God by the power of the Spirit that Yeshua has given us. And that we learn and grow. We're discipled. We're corrected when we're wrong. We confess our sins, and that's all the work of God's law in our heart. And that's what Paul's talking about here in Romans chapter 2. The guy's trying to take it. He suggests there's other ways to read this, and that we shouldn't camp so hard on that interpretation. I don't understand the gain. We know clearly by the time we get to Romans 10 that Paul says that they have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge, right? He says that there's people who love God and love the Torah, but it's not according to knowledge. It's according to their flesh. And then he says that Messiah is the telos of the Torah. In other words, if you might say you love the Torah, but if you see Yeshua of Nazareth, if you say you love the Torah and you read the Gospels and your heart is not ripped open.
Mm-hmm.
And seeing the glory of Yeshua, then you don't really love the Torah. You love something else, and you're hanging the Torah in front of it.
Yeah.
I'll stop there.
No, you're good, man. I agree with you. I do kind of agree with Iconoclast that I think that this is in some... I don't think that Paul can talk about the Torah written on the heart without at least having in... Now, that might not be his point. He might not be trying to specifically... touch on Isaiah 31:31, but certainly I think it has to be in his mind.
Yeah.
Even though the wording's different, right? The wording in Jeremiah 31:31 is different than
the
Greek here.
The difference is that Jeremiah says Torah on the heart, mm-hmm. written on the heart. Paul says the work, singular, of the Torah, written on the heart.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one of the quibbles that the ETS article, or the Jets, Journal of ETS article is saying. So anyway... I'm glad people are chewing on it. I mean, he's engaging with Dr. Wright and, you know, a bunch of other scholars that have written a lot about Paul.
Yeah. So we had one more article in the notes. And actually...
Oh, that's a good point. In the Shema, it does say these words will be on your heart.
Oh, there
but
you go.
The word written isn't there, but you're right, Gil. It is in Deuteronomy. The idea of God's words being on our heart is in Deuteronomy.
Okay, so we have one more article in the show notes, and I guess we'll touch on this really quickly. However, excuse me, there really doesn't need to be a lot said about this. This is a blog by Dr. Eli, or Eli, I think it is. I don't know.
Eli would be Israeli.
It's Jewish Studies blog. Now, he's a Christian.
Oh, he is?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he's got his MDiv.
Oh, I thought that guy was Jewish.
No, and he's part... No. And
Messi,
he's,
or Orthodox.
No, and he's part of the ETS.
Oh.
But he has contributors on his blog, such as Daniel Boyarn, Mark Nanos.
Yeah, I've seen that. So
Anders Runesen, yeah.
He articles about... let me find that. This is the one... Yeah, this is...
It's
is
called
it One Torah or not? Right?
Yeah, One Torah, different laws.
Yeah, this is old school.
Yeah, and that's
this is like
so. Our brother sent this to us, and thank you for sending it to us. But you know, honestly, the one thing that I have to say about this is that he's not saying anything new. You know, he references the Noahite laws for Acts, and no offense to Dr. Eli or Eli or whatever it may be. No offense to him, but honestly, I feel like he's a little late to the party. He wrote this on March 29th, 2016. And, I mean, come on, man. You're like 30 years late. At least you're 16 years late to the party on, in terms of Messianic One Torah studies. And, you know, this is stuff that's all been kind of... tossed over and regurgitated time and time again. So I'm not trying to put him down. I'm happy that he's mulling it over, but it's in the show notes. Y'all can read it yourself. But I really don't find anything new and mind blowing here, or even that he's a Christian guy who's coming to an understanding of Torah. I don't get that either. I get more that he's just starting to have to deal with One Torah theology. What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, he's the fact that he's interacting with like the Mark Nanos, the Paula Fredrickson,
yeah,
and the Daniel Bryan shows me, who what he's thinking like. Both Mark Nanos and Paula Fredrickson are very much like Christians be Christians and Jews be Jews in my understanding.
Yeah.
Now, Dr. Nanos, he'll say, that Christians are Jewish. And what he means by that is lowercase j. Like they're not ethnically Jewish, but a lot of the early believers in Yeshua were Gentiles, adopted Jewish practices. And I like the work that Dr. Nanos has done on that. He's written on the book of Romans, and he's written on the book of Galatians and other things about Paul. This is right along the line of what I would think of the UMJC or who's the rabbi in Virginia, Richmond, Virginia, to the Jews.
Yeah.
Dr. Rudolph.
Yeah, there you go.
Dr. Randall Rudolph or Douglas Rudolph. I don't remember. Dr. Rudolph.
Can we butcher it anymore?
Sorry, Dr. Rudolph. I don't. But Dr. Rudolph's the same thinking that Jews need to be Jews. The Torah is for Jews. Gentiles have this other thing that become, Noahide laws, and that's just how we're to view the world with that map. But you know what? I don't think that's the map that Yeshua had of the world. That's definitely not the map that he taught his disciples or that are in the apostolic writings.
Yeah, exactly.
The map that we see there is all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And if you really receive his Torah, that means it's in your heart. And it means you fall on your face before who Yeshua is. And you see that it's by his grace that he's giving you his spirit. Nothing that you've ever done, nothing that you ever will do will impress God or earn points by which God will now reciprocate and give you some kind of eternal life or Holy Spirit or anything like that. It's a gift. It's operating in a gift. Now, that gift does come with there's expectations. You're part of a family. You're born from above, and there are expectations that you're going to seek. But that's something that's not contrary to our new nature. Our new nature, then, is to desire. We cry out, Abba, Father. We want to do the will of our Heavenly Father. And what he does, he's long-suffering and patient with us as we learn to discern the things of the flesh so that we can learn to put those things to death by the power of the Spirit, and we can walk in more and more holiness and in purity of heart before him. And that's his joy. His joy is to raise up us as his children. And if you can't get that from rabbinic literature. You can't get that relationship by looking to the Mishnah. You can't get that relationship from the Zohar. You can't get... No, those are all systems where people are trying to use behaviors to increase their purity or holiness of heart in this world, thinking that they're going to get to a point where they attain the Holy Spirit. Okay. For us, we're just, boom, we're just born again. Boom, you're a new creation. You're there now. You're like it says in Colossians chapter 3, you're risen with Messiah. Your life is hidden with him. That's, and so be, you know, keep your mind. Think about the things that are above, not, and don't get trapped in the things of the earth. It's just you're a new creation in him, and that's who your identity is. In the Mishnah, you don't have that kind of, there's no teaching like that. You're a man, you're a person, and you got to do all this stuff to try to get more holy. You got to, you know, by the Middle Ages, these Kabbalists, they go to graves. We've talked about this. They lay down on the graves of these sages of ancient Israel, these, you know, Shimon Bar Yochai, you know, and all this stuff, and they pray. And they do automatic speech. They try to have devikut with the soul of this departed person, and they believe that they're going to grow in knowledge of Torah. And it's like, it's you know, those who have the gospel have such a simpler understanding of the scripture and things without having to look to asceticism or man-made religion or... trying to dream of ascending to heaven someday, if I could only just do the right code and say the right Hebrew words at the right time and somehow have a heavenly vision, and I'll be able to see the sages from ancient Israel studying the Talmud in heaven, you know. It's just...
Well, listen to this. Gary says, I don't think he is late to the party. Or late, he says. He's just going through it for the first time. I agree. So maybe that was unfair of me to say. He says, I see in the comment section of the post, I see in the comment section of, I lost it, of the post, he is also referencing the Messianic Gentile site to answer one person's question. So that shows you a little bit where his headspace is. If you're listening to this, you don't know, maybe we haven't explained enough for our new listeners, but if you don't know what the Messianic Gentile site is, it's a site put up by, I think, Rudolph, actually, Dr. Rudolph, and it basically just tells Gentiles, like, oh, yeah, welcome, you stay kind of over here, and the Christian church is kind of for you, and this Messianic thing, you can look, but don't touch, kind of a thing, you know, and go back to where you came from. I mean, obviously, I'm paraphrasing him. He doesn't actually say that, but that's kind of the feeling you get. Here's another thing I want to say. Yes, I haven't been referencing a lot of things, and I haven't been able to pull up sound clips today. And the reason why is because I don't have my computer. So that's one reason that this show has not been, up to the standard that we like to keep here. And I apologize for that to everyone also in the chat room. Once again, I apologize. However, I was going to make a sound clip because one of our listeners said that she had her husband just started listening. And she said, we got a new listener. And
does that mean we lost one? Because we
always
have 36.
That's right. And so I have a sound clip on my other computer for new listeners. And I have a sound clip for listeners who have left to make room for those new listeners. And so next week we'll have a little ceremony welcoming our new listener.
Oh, I love it.
And saying goodbye to the one who has left, whoever it may have been, which obviously we don't know. So welcome, number 36. And goodbye, number 36. But we'll do that all next week, in a special little segment. And if you go out and you get somebody to start listening to the Rob and Caleb show, for the first time, and they become
if you convert. If you convert
somebody to an RC show listener, to a cow tipper, tipping sacred cows. That's what we should call them. No, we should call them something. Anyway, if you convert somebody to be a new listener, then let us know. If you give us a name, we'll even say their name in the official welcome to the show ceremony that we will start doing. Yeah.
Like it.
All right. That's all I got. You good?
I'm great. We had a really good show. We talked about a different, host of different things. I feel like I got a little passionate in there,
I know, and I didn't have my Hoff Goes Off sound clip. Man, I got to tell you, it's really difficult trying to switch computers 2 hours before a show.
I hope the audio's not so bad for our listeners, but.
RC Gear. okay. Anyway, sorry, the chat room's chucking it up. All right. Well, let's start the music then and say goodbye. It has been fun. I've enjoyed it. We've talked about some, controversial things. Hopefully next week we'll get back on track with our sound clips and everything else. I felt a little naked today without all my sound clips and everything. But nonetheless, I hope that...
It's a shame we had a show.
Yeah, exactly. And I hope no matter what, it was still somewhat entertaining and more than that, enlightening, hopefully. And I hope that everybody took something away from it. But most of all, of course, Rob and I always hope that this show does one thing. That is glorify our great God and Savior, Yeshua, the Messiah.